This is Rob Ager. Welcome to part 4 of my analysis on subtext and visual communication in GTA 5. Each of the previous 3 episodes in this series concentrated on an individual story sequence, but now I'm going to shift gears for several reasons. First of all, I'm not going to go into detail about every single scene, because some scenes are more relevant to other GTA 5 videos that I've got planned, and also because some of the scenes are mostly obvious in their implications because the themes are more or less stated outright in dialogue. And other scenes are basically driving from one place to another, and sometimes I'll bring up certain visual elements that are present in those driving sequences, but a lot of it I'll be skipping. I'm also going to try and stick to the main storyline as much as I can in this series. I could easily just wander off around the city with a given character and just explore interesting and thematic details scattered across the entire city, or even the whole island. But another reason I'm sticking to the main story is because the locations that are prominently featured in the story campaign tend to have more subtext communicated in the details. Before we move on sequentially through the story, I'd like to add an observation that one astute gamer made in the comments section of part 2 of this video, which explored the prologue robbery scenes. When FIB agent Dave shoots Brad, he appears to be aiming at Trevor, but Brad walks in the way and is hit by accident.
I'm gonna check around back.
I think that's quite significant regarding the Trevor character. Was the whole thing arranged just to kill Trevor? Okay, so, following on from Mike's therapy scene, lead character Franklin and his buddy Lamar repo 2 sports cars and take off across the city to deliver them back to their employer, a shady motor dealer named Simeon. So outside the dealers we have a big, stupid, smiley, inflatable stick man, which is yet another mismatch between appearances and reality. Simeon is a miserable, hostile man. He claims to be a multiculturalist while revealing himself to be a cynical manipulator who uses the race card issue to try and pressurize people into giving him what he wants. That's obvious stuff, though. Mike's son Jimmy is here buying a car, and he has the word entitled tattooed on his neck. Lamar, however, has a scrawled mess of tattoos that are difficult to make out. Makes sense considering how chaotic and disorganized he turns out to be at many points in the story. Not a lot otherwise going on visually here, except maybe the giant wake-up sign on the coffee vending machine. Is that sign also a shout-out to the gamer? It wouldn't surprise me. So now Franklin heads back to his house, which he shares with his weird auntie Denise, who doesn't like him. Now this is a set piece where a lot of thought has gone into the props. But first I want to mention that the game never explains, as far as I can tell, what happened to Franklin's real parents. In fact, none of the central characters seem to have any kind of positive parental relationships. There are some older people at Michael's fake funeral, and presumably his parents are among them, but they seem to have no other presence in the story. So back to Franklin's home, and we have his bedroom, which we'll explore in another video about his character. But the rest of the house pretty much lays out Auntie Denise's pathology for any player who decides to explore the details. Her world is one of confused identity and denial of reality. The African culture-related pictures and ornaments such as elephants and tribal mask images superficially suggest that she's in touch with her ethnic origins, as does her necklace of bones or teeth or whatever they are, but among her books are titles such as Know Your Clans and Find Yourself, clearly titles that would be appealing to a person suffering from confused identity. In contrast to her African identification, she has a book on Celtic designs, which would be European. Denise also shows signs of being a person with serious emotional baggage, which she desperately wants to sort out. But she's mistakenly turned to wishful thinking, New Age mysticism as her solution. In her bedroom, there's pictures of hearts and meditating figures, pictures of flying doves. Preoccupation with birds in flight can be a sign of a person who desperately wants to escape, hence the flyaway metaphor. There's dream catchers hung up in here, and one or two in the other communal rooms as well. She has books on self-help and healing crystals and healing stones, both in the bedroom and the lounge, and she's certainly taking these books seriously, as there are different types of stones and some very large and hence expensive crystals all over the place. She's got an obelisk ornament in the bedroom and a picture of three eyes in a triangle formation around the sun, proper New Agey nonsense, and a pyramid ornament above the fireplace or radiator place would be a more accurate description. And above all this, another eyes and triangle image. Some people would jump off on a Freemasonry Illuminati New World Order interpretation. It is likely that the designers knew that that implication would be there because those conspiracies are spoken about in dialogue at many points in the game, and make the occasional visual appearance too. But that kind of symbolism is used in New Age literature as well. There's also sun and moon props in the room, which is sometimes used in Freemasonic art, but I don't see Denise as being a Freemason. Anyway, that's all something for a separate video I'll make at a later date on conspiratorial aspects of the game. For now, the New Age nonsense is a perfectly valid explanation of these details. Down here, she has a book on astral something or other, probably astral projections. Its subtitle says 10 Steps to a Better Life, Out with Hate. And she has books like Self-Help for Women and both a book and CD called Power Within. So she's making efforts to solve her problems, but mainly through mystical mumbo-jumbo. And what's the source of her misery? Well, the fact that she lives in Franklin's house with the nephew she dislikes suggests that she has no money or ability to build a life of her own choosing. But the family photos about the place include a male partner, which we can safely assume is a man who has been prominent in her life, perhaps her father, but probably a partner she's no longer with. Did he die or did he leave her? Whatever the reason, she appears to have two shrines, if you will. Above the TV, a picture of this man, and two lit candles and some healing crystals. And two lit candles above the fireplace below the New Age imagery. And there's an incense stick burning and a lava lamp flowing in between these two shrines. We could also take the shrine above the TV as a statement about her addiction to TV for escapism. On the table here, she also has a medication bottle with a cannabis leaf symbol on it, and some Rizzler. Pretty obvious metaphor there. Denise is clearly a woman who's suffering from emotional hang-ups to the point that the term clinical depression might be applicable. Not that it's a term I find useful or accurate generally. The house is in disrepair all over the place and could do with a bit of redecorating. That's often a sign of depression too. Some other personality-revealing details include the yoga books, which in conjunction with the meditation imagery suggest an anxious person. Anxious people are usually obsessed with trying to relax. Behind her bedroom door is a picture of an overweight woman doing some kind of dance. I wouldn't say that Denise is mega overweight, but she's not in great shape either. Sexual frustration is present in the multiple copies of Kama Sutra books and an image of two dancing figures joined at the groin area. Poor diet as well, a couple of loaves of cheap white bread and a box of cereal with an image of a tablespoon heaped with sugar and some dried strawberries mixed in. A good general comment actually. Somehow most people have been persuaded that sugar-filled breakfast cereals are a healthy way to start the day. They're not. And she has a couple of takeaway menus on the walls. Obviously she makes regular use of them. No bowls of fruit or other healthy foods are shown, so if she wants to feel better, then an improved diet would be a great start. An essential one, actually. An airy-fairy rainbow star magnet and an e-cola one too. So, again, poor diet. And a sign reading, Yoga Cancelled Monday, and phone bill with an exclamation mark. She was waffling on the phone when Franklin came in, so her bill is probably a major financial concern. A photo of a little boy up here with a basketball, which might be Franklin as a young boy, or even a son of her own who she doesn't see anymore. Plenty more candles about the place, but unlit ones. She's been reading a magazine article with the title, Gave Up Acting to Save My Sanity. Preoccupations with celebrity industries can make people miserable too. And in the house exterior, things are run down just as they are on the inside and generally in need of a fix. But there's some big mushroom ornaments. Again, New Age, psychedelic, away with the fairies implications. What a troubled woman. When Franklin walks in, there's some sort of TV show on that. I think there's a little bit of dialogue in there, something about breakup of families or something like that. I haven't had a proper look at the TV shows that play in this scene. So, in just this one set, which the player can easily just breeze in and out of without a second thought, there's a ton of information about Franklin's auntie. She's a fairly important figure in the story regarding certain psychological traps that modern women can fall into. Actually, some men can fall into them as well. And her psychological issues get explored more later in the game, both through her character and through some other characters. Right, I'm going to stop there. Hope you enjoyed this. You've been listening to Rob Ager. More videos and articles at my site, collativelearning.com. Until the next episode, take it easy.